In this video, we're going to talk about the t-test and what that can be used for. Now, the t-test can be used to tell us if there's a statistically significant difference between the mean values of two different data sets. Now, we can actually use the t-test as long as the data within each of the two populations is normally distributed. So what does the normal distribution mean? Well, if the data values from a population show continuous variation, that means that the values that are measured are graded over a range of different values from one extreme to another, with most of the values near to or around the mean value. And there's no bias to the left or to the right of the mean value. We might get a bell-shaped curve like the one in the picture, and that shows us a normal distribution around the mean value. Now, this is different from discontinuous variation, whereby we would have distinct categories into which individuals might fall. For example, the blood groups A, B, AB, or O. Now, people will only fall into one of those four distinct categories, and that would be discontinuous variation. But continuous variation, we can see from this graph, we've got a range of values. Most individuals will fall around the mean value in the middle there. Now, as we mentioned earlier, the t-test can be used to find if there's any significant difference between the mean values of two different data sets. So one application of the t-test could be in medicine. Now, if we had a group of patients with cancer, we might want to test how efficient a new anti-cancer drug might be. So if we had one population tested with a placebo, a sugar pill, and then found the mean lifespan of that particular population. So that might be, for example, 7 years after treatment was the average lifespan. We can then start to look and compare that with the lifespan of those patients treated with the anti-cancer drug. So the second population of patients would have been treated with the actual new medication, and the mean value for lifespan after treatment with the anti-cancer drug could then be determined. And we can use a t-test to see if these two mean values are significantly different or not. And if they are, it means that we can actually apply this this scenario to a larger population, and we might be able to say that the anti-cancer drug is significantly effective at extending the lifespan of these particular cancer patients. Now, there's three main types of t-tests that we could look at, the first of which is the independent samples t-test. And that is similar to the scenario that we've just looked at. And this will compare the mean values for two different groups. So it might be, for example, the population of patients with anti-cancer medication versus the population of patients given a placebo. Now, the next t-test is the paired sample t-test. And this is slightly different because it compares the mean values from the same group of individuals or the same population, but just at different times. So for example, here, we could use a paired sample t-test to monitor the effect of a drug, for example, 6 months after treatment versus a population, the same population of individuals, pre-treatment measurements. Now, the third t-test is called the one sample t-test, and that will test the mean value of a single population or a single group against a known predetermined value. So to carry out the t-test, we need to work out a value called the t-value first. Now, the t-value measures the difference between the two mean values of our two data sets relative to the variation within both of the data sets. Now, the t-value is worked out using this equation. You'll be given this in the exam, and by doing enough examples, you can actually learn to use it and be comfortable with the equation. So the t-value gives us the size difference between the two mean values of our two populations relative to the variation within each of the populations. Now, as we go, we're going to learn how to use this equation, how to work out the individual components, and then put them into the equation to work our t-value out. So you might be able to see on the left that S1 here, that represents the standard deviation of our first data set. And S2 represents the standard deviation of our second data set. Now, the equation for standard deviation is given on the right-hand side, and again, we'll be given this in the exam. Now, the standard deviation of a data set really shows how the measurements taken within that group are spread out from the mean value. So a low standard deviation value means most values are near to or around the mean value, whereas a large standard deviation means the measurements within that population, within that data set, are actually fairly spread out away from the mean value. Now, one benefit of using the standard deviation is that it uses all the values within the data set, and it doesn't just rely on extremes, so the highest and the smallest of the values. Now, if we look at the t-value equation in a bit more detail, what we will need to work out before we use the equation is the mean of data set 1. We will then need to work out the mean of data set 2. We've just talked about the standard deviation, so we can work out the standard deviation of data set 1 and then do the same for data set 2. Now, an important part of this t-value equation is N1 and N2. Now, N1 represents the number of measurements we've taken within the first data set. So, for example, if we wanted to test the efficiency or efficacy of a drug, we would have a certain number of patients within the first population. So that would be the N number. It might be N1 was 100 patients, so it would be 100. Now, N2 is the number of individuals within the second population. So it might be 120 patients, so N2 would be 120. So the example of the t-test that we're going to use today is using two different plants. Now, remember, when we do the t-test, we need two different populations of data. Now, one of the plants is going to be in the light, and the second plant is going to be in a shaded area. Now, the plants in the light, we're going to take 15 leaves and measure the width of these 15 leaves. We're going to take the second plant in the shaded area and take 15 of its leaves and measure their width. And we're going to find the mean width value for each plant and then compare them to see if they're significantly different or not using the t-test. So if we have a quick look at the picture beneath, the actual leaf shape, okay, I'll just highlight it here. Now, in order to make a measurement, we need to be consistent with where we take the measurement from for each of the 15 leaves. So in this case, we're going to measure the width of the leaf from the left side to the right side. Now, for each of the 15 measurements, the orientation of the leaves that we'll measure from left to right will be exactly the same. So we're going to take the measurement from the same part of the leaf. Now, before we actually do the t-test, we might want to predict what we'd expect the results to be. So if we have a look at the theory behind photosynthesis, we know that the plants, the leaves in the light, are going to make more ATP and more reduced NADP from the light dependent stages of photosynthesis. If there's more of those products, we know the Calvin cycle is going to progress at a faster rate within the stroma. The Calvin cycle, we know, produces glucose. The more glucose there is inside the plant cells, the more that glucose can be respired, and therefore more ATP can be made. We know ATP is needed for cell division, And cell division is also needed for the growth of these leaves. So we might predict that the leaves from the plants in the light will have a larger surface area. They're going to be wider if we measure the leaves because of the higher rate of photosynthesis compared to those in the shaded area. Now, before we do the t-test, we need to generate a null hypothesis. So it's quite a negative type of idea, and it states in our example that there's no statistically significant difference between the width of the ivy leaves grown in the sunlight and those grown in the shaded area. So there's no statistically significant difference between the mean value of the width of the leaves grown in the light versus the mean value of the width of the leaves grown in the shade. Now, we can also have what's called an alternative hypothesis. And this is pretty much the reverse of the null. So, for example, the alternative hypothesis might state there is a significant difference between the width of ivy leaves grown in the light versus those grown in the shaded area. Now, the t-test will allow us to either accept or reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so if we end up rejecting the null hypothesis, that then allows us to accept the alternative hypothesis, where there is significant difference between the widths of the leaves from our two populations. Now, if the value for our t-test, or t-value, if that exceeds what we call the critical value at the 5% probability level, then you can reject the null hypothesis and accept the alternative hypothesis. And we'll talk about this much more when we actually do the calculations next. Now, if we've got two data sets, so for example, the set on the left, sample one, that might be the measurements we've taken of the leaves in the light. And sample number two on the right-hand side might be the width of the leaves taken from the plant in the shade. So the first thing you have to do for each data set is calculate the mean value for that data set. So if we had 15 measurements of the widths of the leaves in the light, we can calculate a mean value. And quite simply, what you do is on the left-hand side here, you add up all the 15 values and then divide by 15. And that will give you 49, as seen at the bottom. Now, the mean value for sample two, data set two, again, we've got N of 15, so we've got 15 measurements, so 15 leaves that we've measured the width of. And if you add up all the widths and then divide by 15, we will generate the mean value for sample set number two. So the mean value of sample number one, data set one, is 49. The mean value of sample two, data set two, is 29. So once we've calculated the mean value for each data set, we can then go on to calculate the standard deviation for each data set. Now, the standard deviation is really a measure of how the values in a particular data set are spread out from the mean value. So, for example, if we had a large or a high standard deviation number, that would tell us there's quite a lot of variation within the data from the mean value. Now, if the standard deviation value was low or small, there would be little deviation from the mean value. And so all the values in the data set would be nearer to the mean. Now, the equation that we're going to use, and we'll be given this in the exam, is as follows. Now, X represents a single measurement. So in one data set, we might have 15 measurements, for example. X would be one of these. We subtract the mean value from that measurement value. And whatever number we get, we're going to square that. And if we do this for all 15 of the data points or the measurements, we will then add them together. So this symbol on the left represents the sum of. Now, whatever that value is, we're going to divide by the n number minus 1. So n is the number of measurements in the data set. So we've got 15 leaves that we've measured. So n will be 15. And we're going to subtract 1, and that will leave us with 14. So once we've done this calculation, we take the square root of the number, and this will leave us with our standard deviation, i.e. our measurement of the variation from the mean of all the values in the data set. So if we start with sample data set 1, what we can then do is look at our 15 measurements that we've taken, and we can calculate the mean like we just did. Now, we can then work out the deviation of each of the 15 values from the mean value. So quite simply, what we do here is if you look at the second column where we've got this equation at the top, you take the measurements, which is x, minus the mean value, which is 49, and that will give us minus 14. Now, if we do this for each of the 15 values, so for the next one, for example, will be 47 minus 49, which is minus 2. 42 minus 49 is minus 7. And we do that for all 15. If we then take the deviation from the mean and square that value, we can then start to add these together and sum them. So the first value in the end column, if we take minus 14 and square that, we'll get 196. If we take minus 2 and square that, we'll get 4. If we take minus 7 and square that, we get 49. Minus 6 squared, 36. Plus 14 squared is 196. So if you have a negative number and you square it, you'll end up with a positive number. So minus 14 squared is 196. 14 squared is also obviously 196. What we then do is we add the last column together. Now, that symbol means sum of. So we're going to go x minus the mean squared and then sum them together. So all the way down here, and we're going to get a value of, in this case, 3,929. Now, because we've got this value, we've just worked it out, we can now work out the standard deviation for the first data set. So we've just worked out, if you look at the bottom of the page here, we've just worked out this value, the sum of x minus the mean squared for each of our values. Now we've got 15 measurements, so n minus 1 will be 15 minus 1 is 14. So we're going to do 3,929 divided by 14 gives us 280.64. We take the square root of that, and that gives us our standard deviation value for population 1, which is 16.75. Now we do exactly the same calculation for sample number 2, data set number 2. Here we've got 15 measurements. The mean value is 29. We can work out deviation from the mean. So x minus the mean at the top, x minus the mean. So 8 minus 29 gives us minus 21 at the top. 17 minus 29 gives us minus 12. 16 minus 29 gives us minus 13, etc. Now, we take each of those values and we are going to square them. So what we can look at next is x minus the mean squared. So minus 21 squared is 441, minus 12 squared is 144, minus 13 squared is 169, etc. Now, we know sum of x minus the mean squared is what we need to work out. So quite simply, we add up all of the deviations squared, and that will give us, in this case, a value down at the bottom, and that value is 5,157. Now, because we've got this sum of value, we know the standard deviation equation, so we can actually just put in again this value that we've just calculated into our equation. We've got 15 measurements, so n minus 1 is 15 minus 1 is 14. So quite simply, the standard deviation is 5,157 divided by 14, which is 368. Then we take the square root of that value, and it gives us 19.9 at the bottom. So that is our standard deviation of sample data set number 2. So now we can actually work out our t value using the equation provided. Now, there's three values that we actually need to work out, the first of which is the value at the top of the equation. So we need to work out the mean of data set 1 minus the mean of data set 2. Now, 49 minus 29 will give us 20. So we might want to call that value number 1. The second value that we need to work out is the standard deviation of data set 1 squared divided by the number of measurements in data set 1. So we might call this value number 2. So we'll call that number 2 on the right hand side. So standard deviation of data set 1 squared divided by, in this case, 15, because there's 15 measurements, will give us 18.71. Now, the third value that we have to calculate is the standard deviation of the second data set squared divided by the number of measurements in the second data set, which again in this case is 15. So we might call this value 3. So the third value we need to work out before doing the t value calculation is the standard deviation of data set 2 squared divided by n2, which gives us a value of 24.55. Now, because we have these three values, we can now input them into the t-value equation and work out our t-value. So, standard deviation data set 1 squared divided by n1, we know is 18.71. Standard deviation of data set 2 squared divided by n2 is 24.55. That gives us a value of 6.58. We know the mean of data set 1 minus the mean of data set 2 is 20. So quite simply, to work out our t-test value or our t-value, we go 20 divided by 6.58 gives us 3.04. So our t-value is 3.04 to 2 decimal places. Now that we have our calculated t-value, it's very important to be able to compare this to what we call a critical value given in a statistical table of different critical values. So the degrees of freedom number, which is really important when we read off the critical value table, we actually obtain by taking the number of measurements in data set 1 and subtracting 1, added to the number of measurements in data set 2 minus 1. So in this case, we would have degrees of freedom would be 15, because we've got 15 measurements in data set 1, plus 15, because we've got 15 measurements in data set 2, minus 2, which will give us a grand total of 28. So our degrees of freedom in this case is going to be 28, and we're going to need that for the critical value table. So we're now going to talk about the probability table, and this is the table of critical values that we'll be provided with in the exam. Now, in biology, we always use a probability of p equals 0.05, and that means 5% probability. Now, this is the probability that the difference between the two mean values of our two data sets is not significant, and therefore the difference must be due to chance alone. Now, if we think about this, 5% probability that any differences between the means, it is not significant, really also means there's 95% probability that the difference between the two mean values is significant and is not just by chance alone. Now, in biology, this is not, the 5% probability level is not enough to be able to tell us that there is significant difference between our two mean values. So imagine that the p-value that we actually end up getting is, say, smaller than our 5% level. Imagine it was 1%, so 0.01. That would mean there would be a 1% probability that the difference between the mean values is not significant, and therefore a 99% probability that the difference between the two means is significant. So the lower the p-value, the lower the probability that any differences are not significant, and the higher the probability that the differences between the two means are significant. So if our t-value compares to the critical value that we'll look at in a minute and is higher, we're going to say there's a lower probability that there's not significant differences between the two means, i.e. a higher probability that there is significant difference. So the degrees of freedom is 14 for data set 1 plus 14 from data set 2. That's 28. So we're going to read off the table. We're going to use the 5% probability level that the difference between the two means is not significant, and our critical value in this case is 2.05. Now, it's important to remember that we've got two data sets, which is why we add n minus 1 for data set 1 and n minus 1 for data set 2 to get our degrees of freedom. Now, we know our t-test value, our t-value, is 3.04. And that lies to the right-hand side of the critical value. So actually, our t-value is bigger than the critical value. And that means that our p-value is going to be smaller than 0.05. So the probability that the difference between the two means is not significant is actually less than 5%, nearer to 1%, which is really like saying the probability that the difference between the two means is significant is above 95%, and in this case nearer to 99%. So because our t-value is bigger than the critical value from the table, we can reject the null hypothesis, which stated that there's no significant difference between the two mean values. And in this case, we can then accept the alternative hypothesis that there is a higher than 95% probability, in this case nearer to 99%, that the difference between the two means is significant. Now, if our t-value happened to be less than the critical value of 2.05 in this case, in that case, we would actually accept the null and we wouldn't have to really do anything with the alternative hypothesis. Okay, so just to summarize, if the t-value is bigger than the critical value, we are going to reject the null hypothesis, and we're going to accept the alternative hypothesis that there is significant difference between the two mean values. If our t-value is less than the critical value in the table, we are going to accept the null hypothesis that there is no significant difference between the two mean values of the two data sets. Now, in our particular example, the greed to freedom was 28. The critical value was 2.048 from the table. Our t-value is 3.04, which is greater than the critical value. So we reject the null hypothesis, and we can state there is a significant difference between the two mean values, so not just by chance alone. And then quite often in the exam, we might need to say why we think this is the case. So there is a significant difference between the width of the leaves from the shaded area versus those in the light. And we're going to use a bit of biological theory to explain it. So the shaded area trees or leaves have less access to light energy, so their rate of photosynthesis is lower. If the light dependent reactions do not occur to the same extent, then less ATP and less reduced NADP are being made. That means the Calvin cycle in the stroma is not going to occur to the same extent. So less glucose is going to be made, therefore less aerobic respiration and less ATP will be released. We know ATP is needed for cell division. If there's less ATP, there's less cell division, and so maybe the width of the leaves is smaller.